It has been written in letters of blood upon a cross of ignominy. Greater love hath no man than that he should give his life for another. But there is a greater sacrifice than life, and Edward Williams made it. He regained his breath, but it was the breath of agony. He opened his eyes to the bright dawn of peace, but the sun was forever hidden for him behind the clouds of doom. He walked again amongst his fellows, but he walked without hope, helpless and alone. A million voices acclaimed his homecoming, but that mighty shout of triumph was not for his torn lungs. It was for his gleaming beard, for the innumerable bloodstains upon it, for the crimson blaze of glory of the conqueror. Only one was waiting to love and cherish him through sickness as in health, till death did them part.
Hello, darling.
Hello, Alan, dear.
Did you think I was never going to get here? Oh, I had a lot of extra work to do at the office, but extra pay, too. We were going to have the best dinner, a nice big steak, and some of those chocolate cupcakes you like. I bet you're hungry, aren't you?
No, dear, I'm not the least bit hungry.
What's the matter? Is anything wrong? Well, what's the matter with this? Why, Eddie, your compensation starts the first of the month. Oh, just think how much that's going to help. Oh, I love you. I love you more now than when you had everything. Do you believe that?
Of course I believe it, dear.
And work. It isn't work. You know, every time I write a line on the typewriter and I hear that little bell ring, it's just like a cash register, ringing up happiness and success for both of us. Oh, I think about you so often. Well, I think about you so much that when I sign the letters, I almost say love and kisses from Helen.
Oh.
I want you to sit around in the sun, darling. I want you to get well and strong. And one day soon, I'll be sitting here, waiting for the moon to come up. And you'll sing that song to me again. The one you sang when you stole my heart away for peace. Remember?
How could I ever forget? Oh, Helen, you're wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Day after day, he took his medicine, tried to believe he would regain his health. But still that cough tore at his lungs, tore at his heart, until it bled from it all hope. Only love remained to him. And so, when on the night of September the 14th...
Gee, big boy, I wish Helen would come home. She's getting later and later. Every night.
Oh, don't you wait up. You go to bed. She's pretty late tonight.
When the golden a shining, keep on raking hay, and put a little salt on the bluebird's tail before he flies away. When you go to the cottage, boy, I'll be away.
Can't you understand when I say don't do a thing? Why do you burn me up like that? I meant it when I told you not to do it. You'll never play it again. Now go to bed. I want to be alone, understand? Leave me alone!
Go on to bed. Leave me alone. Did you hear me? Go to bed now. I want to be alone.
Leave me alone.
Archie, I know you'll sing again if you'll only try.
Don't try. What do you think I'm doing? Get out of here, will you? Get out of here. Oh, leave me alone. Oh, oh boy. Oh, that old gas. Oh, it's coming over this body. Not gonna catch me in any stinking old gas pit. I gotta live to get off the helm. There! Wet! My mask! Oh! Helen! There!
Tonight. Always you put me off. But
oh,
this time.
Someone might hear you. Oh, please go.
No, I don't care who hears me. As long as you do. I love you. Now you have only hard work. And seldom do I see you smile. And ceases me. Your beautiful face, dear. It's always so sad. Which makes Carl sad. Because I love you, dear.
Now listen, baby. Before I leave, any time you see a head sticking up over there, knock it off.
When Edward Williams saw his wife in the arms of Carl Hummel, he forgot, as all governments have forgotten, the thundering voice on Mount Sinai, "Thou shalt not kill," and remembered only the solemn words, "Whom God hath joined together, let no man put asunder." But when he fired that shot, he did not preserve his home, nor his happiness. He shattered it. There he sits on trial for his life, charged with murder. And there she sits, Helen Williams, his wife. She loves him with a love so great that she is willing to bear not only the scorn and condemnation of the world, but his scorn, his condemnation. If only by her sacrifice she can justify his crime and prevent his conviction. She has concealed from him the truth in order to save his life. She has exacted from me a promise to remain silent. But I am going to break that promise, because I would rather see Edward Williams pass through the little green door that leads to the chair with a smile on his lips, sustained by a love that has never been betrayed, than that he should keep his life and never smile again. Gentlemen, you have heard the truth from the defendant, but you've not heard all the truth. I'm going to tell it to you, though by so doing, I pronounce upon the defendant the sentence of death. Edward Williams did not know that his wife had represented herself to be an unmarried woman, the better to obtain employment for his care, his support. He did not know that Carl Hummel was honorable and sincere in his declaration of love. He did not know, when he closed his basement window on Hummel's passionate plea to go for his gun, that he also shut out Helen's confession of the truth. He did not hear Helen tell Hummel that her husband was a gassed soldier whom she loved more than life itself, and for whom she was ready to make any sacrifice if only she might bring to him something of joy, something of happiness. Because he struggled frantically with the boy Jean, he did not hear Hummel tell Helen, after she'd learned that her husband had been gassed at Croyon, that it was in the same sector that a brave American soldier had tried to save his life, and in so doing had been gassed with him, that ever since he had vainly searched to find that soldier, to repay him, to restore to his torn lungs something of the healing breath of life, as he had been healed by a wonderful German doctor. Had he remained at that window, he would have heard Carl Hummel, overwhelmed by his gratitude to that unknown soldier, promised Helen he would bring that German doctor to America to cure her husband. It is a fact that Edward Williams killed an innocent man. It is a fact he shot him at the moment when his victim was about to repay in full his debt of gratitude. Blinded by fear, asking no questions, he shot down the invader because he believed he was protecting his own home. But was he different from you, from each and every one of you? Were you not blinded by the same fear? Did you stop to ask any questions when not so long ago you silenced the golden voice of Edward Williams as it sang its joyful song of love? Did you not summon him at the very moment when life offered him everything of glory and success because he had youth and strength and courage? Did you not hurry him into a uniform, place a rifle in his hand, sharpen his bayonet, and beg him to go forth and stand between you and the invader? Did you not tear him away from his nuptial kiss and speed him across the seas for the specific purpose of killing Carl Hummel? And if Edward Williams had shot Carl Hummel that Christmas night on No Man's Land, as you had commanded him to shoot, would you not have paused in the very act of lighting the candles on your Christmas tree to offer up a prayer of thanksgiving? And if Edward Williams had spurned Carl Hummel's plea for mercy in that gas-filled shell pit and had plunged his bayonet deep into the vitals of his enemy, would you not have gloried in the tense grip of his fingers? Would you not have applauded the strength of his taut muscles? And would not your government have decorated him? And if Edward Williams had obeyed your orders, had he killed Carl Hummel then, you would not now be sitting in judgment on him for doing the same thing you had ordered him to do. Gentlemen of the jury, the state has demanded that you pass the sentence of death upon this defendant. The prosecuting attorney who led this boy in battle knows better than any other man that even under the stress of war, even when commanded to kill, Edward Williams had nothing but mercy in his heart. And now that you've learned all the facts, all the truth, I will ask you a question. What would you have done if, like Edward Williams, you had believed you were being robbed of your last, your dearest possession, your home, the love of your wife? What would you have done? What would you have done?
If the state has nothing to say in rebuttal, the court will charge the jury.
May it please the court. Gentlemen of the jury, the state asks for an acquittal.
The motion is granted. The court instructs the gentlemen of the jury to bring in a verdict of not guilty.
We, the jury, find the defendant not guilty.
All right. We'll just forget this ever happened. We're going to be so happy again. Eddie, look at me. Eddie, what is it?
Sit down. Wait a minute, sir.
Please, miss, that's my pardon. Let me talk to him, please.
No, I can't do that.
Him and the secretary, please. Please, sir.
Can't help it.
One of my notes, please.
Huh? Sit down, please. Yeah.
Big boy. Big boy, it's me. Big boy.
over there, Joe.
Belongs to me now. Won't you please leave us alone?